Thank you and good evening. Sorry. Thanks for coming out. Are y'all glad that the snow's gone, right? Good grief, we got this bipolar weather. Well, if you didn't recognize that song, then I played it wrong.
That was Norwegian Wood by the Beatles.
Is that my...
Is it cutting out?
Sorry. Okay, we'll figure this out. It's Friday. What's that? She asked if I was gonna do any Johnny Cash. Well, where was I? I don't know what I was talking
about. Oh, yeah.
I was playing that wrong. Anyway, this next song is an original piece of mine that I wrote while listening to banjo music. Any banjo lovers out there?
Yes.
Yeah? Well, I don't admit it very often. And obviously you don't either, because it was a very small smattering of applause there.
But my main purpose is to practice drum movements while
listening to banjo music. This is something that was born out of that practice called Whispers in the Trees. Thank you. boarded the plane, touched down in the land of the Delta Blues, middle of the pouring rain. Won't you look down over me? You opened up first class, Mr. Blue was a boy Ken, when I was walking in Memphis, walking with my feet 10 feet off a pier, walking in Memphis. Do I really feel the way I feel? Saw the ghost of Elvis on Union Avenue. Followed him up to the gates of Graceland. I watched him walk right through. Now security did not see. They just huddled round his tomb. Cause there's a pretty little thing waiting for the king down in the jungle room. When I was walking in Memphis, walking with my feet 10 feet off a bill, walking in Memphis, do I really feel the way I feel? They've got cash on the table, they've got lots pulling in the air. In green, we'll be glad to see you when you haven't got a prayer. Boy, you got a prayer in Memphis. Muriel plays piano every Friday at the Hollywood, and they brought me down to see her. Ask me if I would do a little number, so I sang with all my might. She said, tell me, are you a Christian child? I said, mama, I am tonight. When I was walking in Memphis, walking with my feet 10 feet off a beam, walking in Memphis. A small crowd here, and well, you know, it's small, it's under 300, and but we can treat it like we're small anyway. So I know that the hammer dulcimer isn't, you know, like a piano or a guitar or something that you see every day, so I'm assuming you're all here because of the hammer dulcimer, right? Oh, well, okay. Well, thank you. No, anyway, so if you have any questions about the hammer dulcimer, just raise your hand and I'll try and see you. Yes, ma'am.
What is it?
What is it? That's a very good question. Okay, so the hammer dulcimer is a very ancient instrument. It comes from the Middle East. That's its origins, and it goes all the way back to biblical times. So King David was one of those guys who invented a bunch of instruments. He invented over 500, and the hammer dulcimer was more than likely one of them. We don't have proof of that, but it was just, you know, it doesn't take a genius to take some strings and string it across the board and smack it with a stick. So then I just insulted King David. But anyway. I do that often. Did we just lose that now? We did. This is new, okay? So this GoPro thing is new for me. I just thought that people might want to actually see what's going on. So every time I hear this beep, I'm going to have to turn it back on, unless it's in the middle of a song. So anyway, so yeah, that's where it's from. So it's from the Middle East, very old instrument. Almost every nation in the world has a similar hammer dulcimer. Whether it's the Chinese have the Yanqin, Santur in India, that kind of thing. So, yeah, and then it eventually became the piano. So it is the grandparent to the piano. And I usually explain it to people, they go, what's a hammer dulcimer? I say, it's like a naked piano. So this next song I'm gonna play for you is the original of mine as well. And I wrote it while I was driving through what I consider the most boring part of the United States, otherwise known as Central Illinois. See, I'm in Big Ten country, I can do this. But anyway, so yeah, there's nothing else to do, so you might as well write songs while you're driving through Central Illinois. So this is called Moon on the Water. Thank you. Check 1, 2. We might be in business. Maybe. Check, check, check. 1, 2, test 1. So, I keep forgetting where I'm putting my hammers. Here we go. This, tell you a little bit more about myself real quick. I have, I'm married, been married for just over 20 years. And my wife's name is Donna. She's a little 5 foot nothing and about 98 pounds soaking wet. We have 7 children. And I know, we figured out what was causing it and we moved. Took me a while though, I'm a little thick. But anyway, yeah, we have 7 children, no twins or anything, they all came one at a time. You know, when they come one at a time, they just kind of sneak up on you. So, you know, after 4, it just doesn't really matter. There's too many to take care of anyway. So then you just throw them out to the dogs and let the dogs raise them. Anyway, I hope you honestly don't believe that I do things that come out of my mouth. So don't be shocked and don't go running to social services or anything. We're still good, we're showing? Hi. Okay, good. So this next song I only do when my wife isn't here because she doesn't like it. And you know, my wife is an incredible supporter. I would not be here if it wasn't for her. And by here, I mean here and literally like doing music for a living. So, but she just, it's not that she doesn't like the song, she doesn't like the lady in the song. So you'll understand once we get going here.
Springtime. Stay in here with some friends, and we've got lots of room. You could sell your paintings on the sidewalk at a cafe where I hope that I'll be working soon. So please come to Boston, she said no, or you come home to me. Boston ain't your kind of town. There ain't no gold and there ain't nobody like me. 'Cause I'm the number one fan of the man from Tennessee. We can't be found. So I love you echoes down the canyon. And then we lie awake at night till they come back around. So please come to Denver, she said no. Home to me. Rambling boy, why don't you
I don't really have a right to make fun of Illinois because I live in Indiana and it's flat. But the nice thing that I love about flat lands, and trust me, I love nothing more than driving through Kansas. My wife says I say, come on, we got to move there sometime. She goes, no, I feel naked, very exposed. But that's kind of why I like it. But anyway, there's my main thing is we have gorgeous sunsets in the flatlands, and we also can see storms coming in for miles. So it's always unique when I'm out in Colorado or something, and a storm just suddenly crawls over the mountains, and there it is, and it surprises you. But so we're Midwest tough, so we don't go inside until we see a funnel cloud. The rest of the time, we just stand out there and watch it and enjoy it. So this this one particular one was coming in and looking really menacing and bad, and I was sitting in my in-laws' library, and they had this nice big picture window facing the west. And so, okay, here we go. I don't know why it's doing this. Anybody GoPro fans out there or gurus? Heck no. There we go, we're back on. I'm sorry, you're getting blinded by that flash of light. So anyway, this I sat in the library and played along with the storm. And so this is just simply called Storm. You doing all right? Got any questions?
We're in Indiana.
Okay, hang on. I'll, yes, sir.
Where did you study your instrument and study music and who?
Oh, I'm just a hack. I'm totally self-taught, and so I just studied in my living room. I knew one person who played hammered dulcimer, and he died when my wife and I were on our honeymoon. No correlation whatsoever. God, I hope not. But anyway, so and yeah, he died, and so I just kind of started playing some of his songs, and I grew up playing piano, so I had music theory and stuff. But if you come to the dulcimer from a chromatic instrument, it makes absolutely no sense at all. For those geeks out there, this is a diatonic instrument. So since you can see this, I'll show you real quick. So if you can see this right here, so this is a D. And if I go up one string at a time, what it does is it makes a D major scale. So there's this little box right here. So that's what they mean by diatonic. It already has a musical kind of form to it without doing the chromatic half steps. So to do the half steps, you gotta kind of dance around to get to it, which makes classical music really exciting. So, okay, you asked me,
where in Indiana?
A little town called Goshen. Yeah? Goshen? Yeah, it's right in between South Bend and Fort Wayne. Yes, ma'am?
Have you taught any of your children?
I'm not forcing them. That's a no. My two of my boys, my oldest boys, are actually just very good at it, and very natural. And but then sports and Xbox came along, so they got kind of pulled in a different direction.
Some things come back.
They do, and that's we're trying to just. I'm not one of those parents who does the you must take 3 years of piano or whatever. We just kind of are hoping we're creating an environment, and we have the instruments out there, and they can learn if they get the bug. So I might be wrong, but yeah. Yes, sir.
Do you have different types of hammers for different sounds?
Yeah, I do. I don't switch them as often because I have two sides on these hammers here. One side is like has Dr. Scholl's moleskin on it, and the other side has leather and Dr. Scholl's moleskin. So a lot of people will play with just the bare wood, which I don't really like the tinginess of it, so. So I put Dr. Scholl's moleskin on there to kind of take off that. It's still percussive, but it takes away that tingy sound. Yes, sir?
Two questions. How wide is the striking surface of the E? And does it matter left to right or to the middle? Does that?
Yes. So vertically, I have an inch before I hit a different string. So from here to here is about an inch. Horizontally, I have about 2 to 3 inches before I start running into another string. So if I go and I cross over there, then I end up starting to hit another note, which is kind of, can you guys see that?
Yes.
Oh, cool. So which comes in handy though sometimes because we call those valley chords and they have nothing to do with valley girls. For those of you that remember that, I'm sorry, that was a really bad joke. So on like Norwegian wood, at one point I played. I played in the valley, so I got a three-note chord. So you can use it to your advantage. And then if you hit a wrong note, one of my other idols of the hammered dulcimer said, if you hit a wrong note, just do it twice and it's jazz. So mostly because I'm very kinesthetic, so I like touching the ground, but mostly I'm barefoot because I can feel the pressure on the damper pedal better. So, yes, sir. Okay, so this is the Cadillac of the hammered dulcimer. So this is a $6,000 instrument. but it's got, you know, it's got dampers and pickups and fancy woods and stuff like that. There are, I have a friend of mine who is in Iowa, actually, builds dulcimers, and he considers him the Walmart builder of dulcimers. Not, yeah, you know, it is what it is. But he, and he's okay with that. He just says he would rather build dulcimers and get them in people's homes. And then my builder, he says, well, when they want a real instrument, they come to me. So it all works out. That is Masterworks, yes. But you can get into a dulcimer for $300 to $600 too, so it's not horrible. Yes, ma'am. Oh, the inlays here. It's the Star of David, and then inside it has Hebrew, and it spells Ashar, which roughly interpreted means the Lord makes rich. Comes from a proverb that says, the blessing of the Lord makes rich, and he adds no sorrow with it. So, it's just a reminder. Camera, no? You're pointing to somebody. Oh, okay. Okay, yes.
Your technical question, I noticed your bass bridge is on the left side.
Mm-hmm.
Is that your style of playing that you moved it over there? Because most bass bridges tend to be on the right side.
On the right-hand side? Yeah, I like it on the left, just my style of playing. I've tried to, there's been people who have, other players who have tried to convince me to go to the right side, and it just doesn't feel right to me. I also think it, by having it over here, you have a longer string that can resonate, and I think it gets a different tone. Also, when you stick it over here, you have two bridges right next to each other, and that kind of dampens the soundboard from vibrating, where over here you have more. That might be more than you were asking for, but sorry. Okay, yes?
I'm just curious about that technique. It looks like you're not really hammering, you know, like a massive instrument, or like you're talking about more letting the weight of the hammer drop onto it. It's more like a light touch.
Yes, very much so. That's a good eye, yes. People ask me a lot, do you get tired? And it's like, no, if I get tired or sore, then I'm doing it wrong. So it really is, I teach all my students, it's just a flick. It's all that it is, and you can just control it. If you squeeze it too tight, then you start playing with your wrist or your arm, and you just can't get very musical or fast in that way. So when I'm playing outside, I tell them the wind should be able to blow the hammer out of your hand, or I should be able to come by and just smack it and have it fall. So yeah, it is just a... Just a nice flick. Okay, I'm not overlooking you.
No, there are several types of dulcimers. What distinguishes a hammer from the kind that you...
Like the mountain dulcimer?
Correct.
The strummed?
Right.
Everything. Right. they share the same name, and I have no idea. Nobody knows why, because they have nothing to do with each other. That's more of a lyre type instrument. This is obviously just a more of a zither kind of instrument. Yeah, they just differentiate by, this is hammered because I'm striking it with a hammer. The mountain dulcimer is just strummed like a guitar.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes, sir?
Is there a four-hammer technique?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And it's similar to what I was saying. Thankfully, I can't demonstrate it very well. So you just see people holding the hammers so that they're not swinging, and they're just doing all the motion like this. I don't think it hurts anybody to do that, as far as getting carpal tunnel or anything like that. It's just a sound and a technique. Is that what you were asking? Okay. Sorry, you guys have a lot of questions. So what am I doing? I'm gonna play this song for you. So this song was I picked up from a guy by the name of Dookie McLean, and yes, I see some guys. He wrote this song for his grandfather. He comes from a fishing family, and they have this amazing tradition in the Scottish fishing families, where in the villages they will. Each family will have a certain design knit into their sweaters. And they do this, one, because, like, you know, they make them sweaters because they're going to go out on the sea for months at a time. And, you know, having a vocation of fishing is not like, you know, working at Walmart. You know, it's a little more dangerous than that. And so they never really know when someone is not going to make it home. And if one of the sweaters washes up on shore, the village will know which family it belongs to. So, what, blind your eyes, cover your eyes? I'm sorry, folks. I'm just trying something new. Okay. So this is called Ready for the Storm. Tide rolls out, it's an angry sea, but there is no doubt that the lighthouse will keep shining out to warn this lonely sailor. And the lightning strikes and the wind cuts cold through the sailor's bones, through the sailor's soul, till there's nothing left that he can hold except this rolling ocean. Oh, I am ready for the storm. Yes, sir, ready, I am ready for the storm. I'm ready for the storm. Oh, give me mercy for my dreams, 'cause every confrontation seems to tell me what it really is to be this lonely sailor. And when the sky begins to clear and the sun it melts away my fear, I cry a silent weary tear for those who mean to love me. Oh, I am ready for the storm. Yes, sir, ready, I am ready for the storm. I'm ready for the storm. Take its time, you will find that in the end it brings you me, this lonely sailor. And when you take me by your side and you love me, warm me, love me, and I should have realized, had no reason to be frightened. Why am I ready for the storm? Yes, sir, ready, I am. Yes, sir, ready, I am ready for the storm. Yes, sir, ready, I am ready for the storm. I'm ready for the storm. I'm gonna play a brand new song for you that just came out. I don't have it on CD or anything like that. It's on, if you do digital music, it's on Spotify and Apple Music and stuff like that. This song was born from 2017. And in general, I usually start out by saying 2017 was a pretty rough year for America, wasn't it? And I, don't worry, I'm not, you know, not going to get political or anything like that. It really has to do more with all the tragedies that were happening during that time. There were tons of shootings, there were floods and fires, all kinds of stuff just happening, and you were just like, man, you just couldn't catch your breath, you know? And at one point, I really felt and wondered if this is the way it's going to be? Is this how America's just going to function? And I felt like we started to lose our humanity. We started to lose our compassion and our, you know, toward one another and just being human to each other. And one tragedy in particular that really hit home to me was the shooting down in Sutherland Springs, Texas. And it struck me mostly just because of the sacredness of it, yes, but the vastness of range of life that was affected. There were unborn babies and 90-year-olds that were killed. And it was just, I don't know, that one seemed even more random than most, but I'm not going to get into arguing with that. But that one, for me, was the one that was just the straw that broke this camel's back. And I didn't know what to do. And I was just heartsick and broken for America, because I know more than being a good country, we're good people. And I know you guys are, even though I don't know you personally. I get to meet you and I get to travel this nation and meet wonderful people who make up America. America is only as great as the people that are in it, okay? It's not government people. If you're waiting for government to change our lives, it ain't gonna happen. You're gonna be waiting a long time. And I'm not saying that because I'm Republican or Democrat or anything like that. I'm just, it's a big train. It takes a lot of momentum to move it. But it really starts and finishes with us and how we treat our neighbor. And so for me, I'm not a good mechanic. If you want to hear me swear like a sailor, let my car break down and me try to fix it. I mean, it's not a good scene. I'm no good with that, but I can write music. I play music. I can play music that people say it touches their soul. And, you know, you might be a great baker. You might make the best chocolate chip cookies in your neighborhood. You might mow lawn better than anybody else. You might be a mechanic that can fix things when tragedy strikes. We all know people who have faced tragedy of some sort, whether it's the love of a lost, the life of a loved one that was lost, whether it was a neighborhood shooting or something that happened that just seems to take the breath out of you. And it just sucks the life out of you, and you're left wondering, is this all there is? And I'm firmly convinced that we can make this life better one kind act at a time. And so don't forget, among all of our differences and the way we believe government should be run, or even neighborhoods or churches or whatever, among all our differences, we all bleed, we're all human, we all have the same heart. Don't forget that. And do what you do to make this world a better place. This is called The Old and the Young. Thank you. and children, we are gathered here to hear the sacred story, and I'm glad to bring it to you with my best rhyming and rhythm, cause I know the thirsty listen down to the waters come, and the holy king of Israel loves me in America. Songs. I hope you hear the water falling. Hope you hear the oceans crashing off the coast of North New England. I wish I could be there just to see it. 2 summers past I was, and the holy king of Israel loves me in America. And if I were a painter, I do not know which I'd paint. The calling of the ancient stars or assembling of the saints. There's so much beauty around us for just 2 eyes to see. And everywhere I go, I'm looking. Once I went to Appalachia for my father, he was born there. And I saw the mountains waking with the innocence of children. And my soul is still there with them, wrapped in the songs they wrote. And the holy king of Israel loves me here in America. And I've seen on the highways of 1 million exit ramps, two-legged memorials to the laws of happenstance, waiting for four-wheeled messiahs to take them home again. Cause I am home anywhere if you are where I am. And if you listen to my songs, I hope you hear the water falling. Hope you feel the oceans crashing off the coast of North New England. I wish I could be there just to see it. 2 summers past I was, and the holy king of Israel loves me here in America. Well, I have a, tonight is the night of new songs, so I have another brand new song for you that's not even out there yet. So you guys are the third group of people that have heard this song. It's quite fitting. After Here Comes the Sun. And so this one, I got the idea from a friend of mine who posted a picture on Facebook of a crocus. I didn't even know what a crocus was until I saw it. And it was just a beautiful picture where it was just this beautiful, bright little yellow flower that was just protruding up through the ground, and there was snow all around it. And so I started looking online for some other crocuses, and I was struck by the tenacity of it. And it inspired me to write a song. So this is called March of the Crocus. Out there? Good. I'm trying to stay in relative pitch to myself here. Well, this next song is a story of 7-year overnight success. If you don't know what I'm talking about, I'll tell the story after this. Story. Yeah, a few of you. So just to give you the short version, Facebook Live had just come out, and so I used to do this thing on YouTube where just because I didn't have any gigs, I would work up songs and I would have people like suggest songs for me to do, and then in a week I would learn them and play what I could on Friday. So I got everything from like Dancing Queen by ABBA to Pantera. And yeah, I never did learn a Pantera song. If you don't know, any Pantera fans? Oh, really? There you go. There's always one. No, anyway. you're the Pantera fan in Milwaukee. No, anyway, so Facebook Live had just come out, and we have a little apple orchard in our backyard, and so I took the dulcimer out there, and I played a song. And it's actually going to be the next song I'm going to play for you. And I think there were like 7 people that showed up, you know, on Facebook Live, and I think we had like 47 views, you know, by you know by the end of the week. So my wife said, hey, you gonna do the you know, Facebook Live thing on Wednesday again? I was like, I don't know. Wasn't very profitable or popular, you know? So she goes, you should do it. People, you know, it's fun, just go do it. I was like, fine. Well, I had been working on that song, Everybody Wants to Rule the World, for a while, and just off and on, kind of touching on it here and there, and I thought, okay, I'm gonna go try and do this song and see if it'll come together in time. So the Wednesday morning, I started working on the song, and it started to come together for whatever reason, and I was like, okay. So I think I'll play that song. So I played that song, and in 2 days, we had 54 million views. In 4 days, we had over 80 million views, and as of now, it's over 102 million views. So, it's a 7-year overnight success, and, you know, you're doing music for a living now. Yeah, I've been doing that for about 8 years now, but thanks for asking. So, My whole thing is just I tell people, just keep showing up, okay? That's what you gotta do, just keep showing up because you never know what's gonna happen. So there was a short story other than that, and there it goes again. There was a short story beside that. Kurt Smith of Tears for Fears saw the video and friended me on Twitter and sent me some, you know, messages. And he invited my wife and I. Are we out of battery? Wow, this experiment is not going well. Anyway, he said, hey, we're gonna be down in Indianapolis. I think I'm out of battery. Well, stink. All right. And he said, I'd love to give you tickets for you and your wife to come down. And we said, oh, sure, why not? And so we did, and they gave us like center row, you know, center stage, 8 rows back. It was magnificent. And so we went backstage afterwards. They gave us backstage passes, and we met Kurt and Jamie, the drummer, and Roland. And Jamie said, hey, we're gonna be in Cleveland in 2 days, but we'd like to take tomorrow off, and we'd like to drive up to your place. Would you mind if we came? It's like, okay, sure. And So he and Jamie drove up and took the day off, and we fed him Amish crack donuts, or we just call them Amish crack. Has nothing to do with plumbers, but I think they lace it with cocaine because you just can't stop eating them. So in our area, we call them Amish crack donuts, and fed them coffee, and they played with the kids, and we played music together, and then Kurt said, well, why don't we work up a rendition of Everybody Wants to Rule the World? I'll sing, you play, Jamie will beat on something, and we'll go Facebook Live. So I said, okay. And so we did, and that was another magical carpet ride. So this song is inspired by the screams of my children. And The short story behind it is we had one of those massive downpours where it's just like you turn the faucet on, and there it is. And so I was inside, and I just heard my three little ones, Lissa, Lyra, and Jesse, just, you know, giggling and laughing and yelling and all this kind of stuff. And so I went outside to see what was going on, and they were rescuing the cats. So the cats had all taken refuge under the vehicles, and they were perfectly dry, but they needed rescuing from the storm. So they were out prancing around in the rain and rescuing kitties. So this is called Journey Through the Rain. Thank you. Excuse me. Wow. I had the tickle creeping up my throat during that song. Trying to clear my throat and not cough into the microphone. I had tears coming out of my eyes. And that wasn't because I was thinking of my children. I have a 20-year-old, soon to be 20-year-old, and all the way down to six. So we pretty much went every 2 years until the last two, and we had 4 years in between there. We must not have had enough going on. We have, I have four girls and three boys. And I'll tell you in order. So Leia, Wesley, they're 20 and 18. 16 is Lindy. 14 is Seth. 12 is Lissa. So 10 is Lyra. And then Jesse is six. So I need to write a lot of hit songs because I'll have some weddings coming up. I'll have to mention college if that's in the books. So anyway, hey, thanks so much for spending the evening with me. I hope you enjoyed yourself. I want to say thank you to everybody here. I know I'm going to forget some names and everything, but Lynn and Katrina's not here, but I know Lynn was very instrumental in bringing me here. Derek for running sound, you're awesome. Thank you. James for running the visual, and even though he covered up all whatever mistakes I could possibly throw his way. Oh, darn it. I just forgot your name.
Shane.
Shane's over here doing lights. Yeah. So thank you so much for coming out. And I do have, if you didn't see, I have some CDs out there, t-shirts, hats, can koozies, because summer's a-coming. But anyway, I hope to do this again sometime.
Yes, thank you.
So, thank you. I'll leave you with another old English tune. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Be safe. Have a great summer. God bless. See you again. Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate it. We'll see you again sometime. Come out and say hi, please.